We've been studying how to deal with messy relationships, although absent from studying together for several Sundays now. And the first Sunday in this unit was dealing with how to love people and how to encourage them and how to forgive them and then how to serve them. Last week was yielding to them. And so now this week we're looking at a lesson entitled To Accept Them. It comes from Romans chapter 14, verses 1 through 4. And then 13 to 19. This lesson deals with differences of opinion, mainly, and how we shouldn't let differences damage our relationships. And there seems to be always two extremes. If you don't believe just like me, then I'm going to have nothing to do with you. And if you believe differently than I do, then I'll just rubber stamp and endorse your belief as okay or acceptable. And as usual, either extreme is biblically wrong. And so here's the lesson today is going to give us some practical biblical direction on how we can accept one another. And the Bible's opinion, or God's opinion, will be the final authority. So let's look at Romans 14, 1 through 4 to begin with. Receive one who is weak in the faith, but not to disputes over doubtful things. For one believes he may eat all things, but he who is weak eats only vegetables. Let not him who eats despise him who does not eat, and let not him who does not eat judge him who does eat. For God has received him and all of us. Who are you to judge another servant? To his own master he stands or falls. Indeed, he will be made to stand, for God is able to make him stand. All right, so the crux of the lesson then is to accept one another and our differences of opinions, and particularly in things that just don't matter. And disputes among religions is as old as the Old Testament. And in the New Testament, during the time of Jesus Christ and the apostles, the new Christian church had its divisions and contentions, same as the new church in modern America today. The Corinthian church was suing each other. The Galatian church was bickering. Ephesus and Colossae, they had their disunity and issues. At Philippi, there were two women who were at odds with each other, and that led to a split as everybody took sides on one or the other. And I tell you, that's despicable. And most of the problems always stemmed back to non-biblical opinions based on tradition, had nothing to do with Scripture at all. You know that the Jews, they came up with the law and the holy days, and then when Jesus Christ came and the new covenant took over, the new Christians, particularly the Gentiles, they didn't know nothing about the law and the dietary laws and the law that Moses had given. They knew nothing about that. And the new believers in Rome, they were divided over diets and special days. You know, some thought it was wrong or sinful to eat meat. Some thought it was wrong to eat meat sacrificed to idols. Some thought if you didn't observe special days that that was sinful. And they were all criticizing each other and judging each other. And each group thought they were spiritually superior to the other, which is also despicable. You know, the very minute you get to thinking that you're better than somebody, you ain't. I can assure you of that. And so it continues to this day. And there are those gray areas that are not clearly right or wrong to every believer. The Bible is quite clear on many things, whether it's right or it's wrong. The Bible, God's Word, clearly condemns some things, and it clearly commands some things. You know, it condemns homosexuality is always a good one. But it clearly commands us to observe the Lord's Supper. And so the Bible is very clear on the things that it does say matter. All right? But those things that are not clearly defined requires another kind of guidance. Now, back to verse 1. He talks about those who are weak in the faith. And so what Paul is talking about is newly converted or immature believers. And Paul is talking to the mature believers, the strong believers, to accept the ones that are weak or that are immature or that are brand new believers, because their understanding of their faith in Jesus Christ has not matured yet. They have not grown in the Lord. And particularly about those things that are nothing more than opinion. And Paul refers to those as doubtful things or doubtful disputations. Then in verse 2 and 3, Paul gives an example about eating meat, generally or specific. So let's remember at the time of Paul's writing, Christ had come and ushered in the new covenant. The old covenant had been abolished. Christ came to fulfill the law, which meant that the old dietary laws, the old rituals were now obsolete. And one of those that Paul's referring to here is that the Jews were forbidden to eat pork. That was one of the laws that was made to make the Jews distinct from other peoples. It was a dietary law. Now, under the new covenant, it was completely okay. And Paul and Peter both had to learn that lesson. But that centuries-old tradition was still strong in a Jewish mind. And there were Gentiles, that knew nothing of the law, and they had become Christians, and they were coming out of idol worship. And so their problem was eating meat that was sacrificed to idols, and now that meat was being offered for sale in the marketplace. And so they thought it would be wrong to eat that meat, or they would be inquisitive about, okay, where'd that meat come from? Because it's sinful if I was to eat it, and it was sacrificed to some idol. And so here's what Paul's saying. Nothing wrong with any of it. Nothing wrong with any of it. It's not what goes into a man's mouth that defiles him. It's what comes out of him. And so the Bible's very, very clear on that. But that issue was a big deal in those days. And to some extent, it's still true today. I know some Jews that will not eat pork to this day, and they're converted Christians. And to them, it would hurt their conscience, and they shouldn't eat it. And you know something else? If you know that, and you invite them to your house for supper, don't be serving them no ham. I mean, if you already know it, that would be wrong for you to do it, because in their mind, it's still wrong for them. All right, so there are Jews that have been converted to Christianity and still refuse to eat pork. And that's perfectly fine to me. That's an issue that makes no matter to me at all. Now, that was the issue of that time, and Paul was using that as an illustration. Now, what about some modern examples that we can use today? So let me just throw out two or three, because these come up sometimes. I'm asked about them sometimes. And so here's a couple that's close to me. What about having a glass of wine at dinner? Don't bother me a bit. If I was to go out with this couple and they wanted to have a glass of wine with their steak, it wouldn't bother me one bit. Would I do it? No. Because it would bother me. It don't bother me if they done it, but I'm not going to order it. So what's the problem here? Am I being hypocritical or double standard? Absolutely not. A glass of wine with dinner bothers me not one bit. But listen, I'm a Sunday school teacher and a deacon at Walkerville Baptist Church, and I despise alcohol with every fiber of my being. And so for me, it would absolutely be wrong for me to set some kind of example that it's okay. Even though that don't bother me in the least, I wouldn't do it. Wrong for me, okay for them. Now, I'm just talking about a glass of wine at dinner now. We could go on chasing a lot of rabbits here. And so, movies. Miss Pam and I, we'll go to faith-based movies at a secular movie theater. Recently, just matters of weeks ago, we went and saw a movie called I Still Believe. And it was playing in one room, and there could have been, I didn't notice, there could have been a triple R rated movie playing next door. Now, does that bother me any? Nope. I didn't go to see that movie. I went to see the other one. But someone may say, well, you ought not to go to that place, that hellhole of iniquity. Well, if it bothers you, don't go. It don't bother me. I'm not going to see that movie. I'm going to see the other one. Now, I'm going to get to another example where it may sound like I'm going to change, but that's later in my notes. Anyway, another example. Restaurants that serve alcohol. Go or not? Well, I don't know if you can go to a restaurant these days that don't, but it don't bother me to go to a restaurant that serves alcohol. I'm not going to buy it. And then someone says, well, aren't you supporting that? Well, I guess you could make a case for it, but it don't bother me. If it bothers you, don't go. All right? So, Sunday activities, another. I grew up, was raised by my grandfather, my maternal grandfather, those of you that know Rufus Smith up at Bristol. And he grew up that fishing on Sunday was wrong. That was just of the devil. It was okay to go skiing Sunday afternoon, do some other things, but fishing on Sunday, that was just dead wrong. Now, where did he get that? Tradition, opinion. I don't know where he got it from. Is it right to do good or bad on Sunday? Well, I think it's fine to do good on Sunday. And so on and on and on we can go. Holy days. Some people won't go back to church on Sunday night. Used to bother me years ago. Doesn't bother me no more. You know, that's between them and God. I got bigger fish to fry. I've got more things to be concerned about than whether or not somebody comes back on Sunday night. Now, I would say that if your church offers Sunday night services, then you ought to go. But am I going to fall out with you if you don't? No. Same thing on Wednesday night. You know, God, through the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, is telling us that some things don't matter. It's not worth offending people, grieving people, or causing them to stumble, and things that don't matter. All right? Now, some things do, but let's not fall out with one another and start judging one another and condemning one another and being critical of one another for those things that boil down to just a personal preference or some historical tradition. Listen, when it comes to the gospel, we certainly do have to have unity and truth. No compromise. And many times I've given this as an example, and I don't remember if I stole it from Jerry Vines or Adrian Rogers, but it don't matter. It comes from a pretty good source. The virgin birth, the virtuous life, the vicarious death, the victorious resurrection, and the visible ascension and return of Jesus Christ. That is the gospel. We have to have unity on that, because that's the truth. We can't have unity without truth. Now, you take away any one of those truths, and you cease to have the gospel. You cease to have Christianity. So those things matter. All right? Those things are essential. Those things are essential to our Christian unity, because those things are the truth. But those things that are non-essential, those things that are opinion, boils down to a Christian liberty. But in all things, let love reign. In all things, let love reign. The Bible clearly teaches us that love will cover a multitude of sins, or multitude of things. The lesson is clear. The weak does not have the right to call the strong unspiritual, and the strong, mature believers do not have the right to criticize or call the weak immature or criticize them in any way. The Bible says that God has received both of us. God has died for both of us. And once upon a time in your Christian beginning, you were a weak Christian. You were immature, and things bothered you that didn't matter. But God has received both of us. And so we should receive or accept one another. Don't argue, don't dispute over non-essential matters. Listen, we got more things to be concerned about. We shouldn't be judging or despising one another. Why? Well, verse 4. Who are you to judge another servant? To his own master he stands or falls. Indeed, he will be made to stand, for God is able to make him stand. Listen, nobody is to presume the place of God. God said, listen, I'm the master here. You got no business taking my place or usurping me. We're the servants. He's the master. You know, there's a personal relationship there, and nobody should interfere with this relationship. God is the judge. Not you, not me, not Greg, not Buddy, or wherever you may attend. Now, it is appropriate that we pray for each other. It is appropriate that we advise each other when there's opportunity. And it's also appropriate that we admonish if necessary. And so those things will come up, and if there's an opportunity to encourage or straighten somebody out on a matter of Scripture, you do it in love and not in a sarcastic or judgmental way. You let love reign in that, and you'll be winning your brother and helping him grow in the Lord. But to do it without love is absolutely wrong. Got to do it in the right spirit. There ain't no playing God here. There ain't no taking the place of God. I'm reminded of John chapter 21 in verses 15 to 25 after Peter had failed and Jesus had restored him. You know, the line about Peter, do you love me? Do you love me? And Peter then asked Jesus, talking about John, he asked Jesus, what about this man? And Jesus answered and said to him, well, what is that to you? You follow me. And so that is what Jesus was saying. Peter, you make sure you have made me Lord of your life. You let me worry about John. And so, you know, that's pretty good advice. You got more to worry about, well, not worry, but be concerned about, than somebody's other non-essential matter. Listen, there are people dying and going to hell in this world. There are people who have great needs, who are suffering, death of a loved one, this whole coronavirus thing, there's people getting stressed out. I mean, there's worlds of things, of good things that we can do and be concerned about rather than talking about eating a piece of ham or not. So Jesus said, what is that to you? You follow me. You make sure you made me Lord of your life, Peter, and let me worry about John. So let's let Jesus then worry about those things that don't matter, all right? And so we could point out then, what is that non-essential thing to you? What is it that you're hung up about? Listen, if you've got a real issue with somebody, it might be a good idea to go talk to somebody else first, like your pastor, your Sunday school teacher, and get their side of it, or get their opinion of it, or their biblical background, before you go and talk to someone else about their issue. And so a lot of these non-essential things, follow Christ. Let him be Lord. Now verses 13 to 15. Therefore, let us not judge one another anymore, but rather resolve this, not to put a stumbling block or a cause to fall in our brother's way. I know and am convinced by the Lord Jesus that there is nothing unclean of itself, but to him who considers anything to be unclean, to him it's unclean. Yet if your brother is grieved because of your food, you are no longer walking in love. Do not destroy with your food the one for whom Christ died. And so here's the bottom line here. He says, we affect each other. You ever heard that saying, no man is unto himself, no man is an island? You're not. I mean, you're not alone in this world. And you're not alone in your Christian walk. The things that we do can have a profound effect on somebody else. And we need to be conscious of it, those of us who've been around for a while. We affect each other. You know, we can cause another person to stumble. We can grieve another believer. We can even cause great anguish and pain. And it's easy to do. And we can do it almost without any effort at all. These scriptures here run parallel with 1 Corinthians chapter 8. And it talks about knowledge puffing up and love builds up. Knowledge will puff up and love builds up. So the strong Christian may have spiritual knowledge, but if he doesn't practice spiritual love, then his knowledge can hurt the weak or the immature or new Christian, and he would be wrong. You can be biblically, scripturally sound doctrine, and do it and say things in an unloving manner, and you'd be wrong. Now, that's what he's talking about here now. That's Bible. Verse 14 gives us a good example of knowledge versus love. And I think I've already alluded to it, but like the example of offering pork. You know someone has a problem with that, and you know it, don't let it be an issue. I mean, if you're going out to dinner with them and they order a steak and you're like, okay, now do I order that pork chop or do I order the shrimp? Order the shrimp, for crying out loud. Because if you're doing it because, okay, I've got Christian liberty, I got the knowledge here, I'm going to order that pork chop just to show him that he's wrong. I hope you choke on it. Because that's wrong for you to have that attitude. Now, if you don't know, you know, that's a different matter. And, you know, that'll come up in another, you may have to apologize or something. But if you know it, then it's absolutely wrong for you to offer it or to eat the pork in another person's company. So is it really worth the potential harm to a brother just so you could enjoy your Christian liberty? Paul always took the high road on that. He said, no, if I know it's going to be offensive, I'll do without. You know, I'll not do that just to win my brother. Let love reign. Years ago, I was at a revival meeting. And for the life of me, I can't remember where. I can't remember who the preacher was. I can see him in my mind. But he gave this as an example. This preacher, this evangelist, he and his wife had gone to the movies. Now, this preacher was an evangelist, but he's also pastor to church. So he lived in a community and pastored a church. And so he and his wife went to the movies, and there was a new Christian in their congregation. And this new Christian saw the pastor and his wife going to the movies. And she fell out with that. Approached the pastor and said, I can't believe you went to that place. I just can't believe that. You know what the pastor did? Well, he tongue-lashed her. No, absolutely not. It broke his heart. You hear what I said? It broke his heart that he had offended this new believer. You know what he said that he'd done from that day forward? He'd never go to the movies again. That's right. That's right. He was willing to give up a Christian liberty because it offended another weak believer. Now that's the high road. That's what this whole lesson is about. Accepting one another. Those of us who are spiritually more mature than someone else, when we exercise our knowledge, our Christian liberty, you're not allowed to do it at the expense of offending or grieving another believer. And that's what the Bible says. So the issue is not how does something non-essential affect me, but how does it affect my brother or my sister? Will it cause him to stumble? Well, if it does, then don't do it. Will it grieve him? If it does, don't do it. And here's another good one. Would it encourage him to sin? Now we're thinking about the alcohol thing. I'd have to be dead and somebody pour that stuff down my throat. I'm not going to touch it. No desire to. I hate it with every fiber of my being. But if someone who is like a recovering alcoholic goes out to dinner with a mature Christian who has no problem with a glass of wine, and I don't have a problem with it either, for someone else to do it, and he does it, and this guy's a recovering alcoholic, would it encourage him to, okay, well, I'll have a glass of wine too. Does that put him back down that path again? Well, if it does, then it's absolutely wrong. It's absolutely wrong. So, will it encourage? Those are the things to ask. Will it cause my brother to stumble? Will it grieve him? Will it encourage him to sin? If the answer to any of those is yes, then don't do it. Yes, you've got the Christian liberty. Yes, you've got the knowledge. But Paul is writing to the strong, mature Christians and saying that those who are mature and strong should think about or at least consider what you might be doing by exercising your Christian liberty. Because if it's going to grieve, offend, or encourage someone to sin, then you ain't got the right to do it. That's what the Bible says. So Jesus said that if we were a stumbling block, what did he say? Tie a millstone around your neck and throw you in over your head. That's pretty strong words. That's what Jesus thought. Now, verse 16 to 19. Therefore, do not let your good be spoken of as evil. For the kingdom of God is not food and drink, but righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. For he who serves Christ in these things is acceptable to God and approved by men. Therefore, let us pursue the things which make for peace and the things by which one may edify one another. So here's a quick summary. Like the Pharisees of old, we Christians have a way of majoring on the minor. Non-essential things. All right? Churches have absolutely divided over such minor and trivial things as where are we going to put the piano in the new church or the color of the carpet. And those stories have been told over and over and over. How important is that, something like that, compared to the things that really matter, like salvation, sanctification, and service? The kingdom of God is not meat and drink, trivial things. It's not the external things that matter. It's the eternal things that matter. And he says it's righteousness, peace, and joy. And where do all these things come from? From the Holy Spirit. And so here's the take home. Here's the take home message. If each believer would yield to the Holy Spirit and major on a godly life, we would have a great testimony before the rest of the world. I am thoroughly convinced that one of the issues with the Christianity of today, we don't have a testimony, we don't have any power, we don't have a light or salt left in us, is because we're not practicing what we know. And we usually always know more than what we actually practice. And so we would have a great testimony then before the rest of the world if each of us as believers would yield to the Spirit and major on a godly life.